Good morning, brothers and sisters. So, Brother Lee Brainerd and Brother Mondo Gonzalez had an excellent discussion on 2 Thessalonians 2, talking about the apostasy. Is this a spiritual or physical departure? And does this refer to the rapture? This verse has huge implications. And so I have shared that live stream on my Telegram page so you guys can check it out. But what I wanted to do was read this article from the other side of things by Dr. Andy Woods. And you can read this article for yourself on pretrib.org. That's pre-trib.org. I'll put the link in the description page for you. But I wanted to make a video on this article because I think it really explains well the other side of it and the implications for it. So in 2 Thessalonians 2:3, it says, "Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition." The immediately preceding verse of 2 Thessalonians 2:2 indicates that during Paul's absence from Thessalonica, a forged letter had begun to circulate in their midst, allegedly having come from Paul, telling the New Thessalonian believers that they were in the tribulation period. When Paul was with them, about 6 months to a year later, he had taught them that they would be raptured to heaven prior to the tribulation period. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 and 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18. Now, because of this forged letter that had come into their midst, the Thessalonian Christians thought they were in the actual tribulation period. Consequently, Paul responds in 2 Thessalonians 2:3 through 12 by laying out five reasons why the day of the Lord has not yet started. He explains that the day of the Lord has not started yet because there is no apostasy, verse 3. Advent of the lawless one, or Antichrist, verse 3 through 4. The removal of the restrainer, verses 5 through 7. The destruction of the lawless one, verses 8 and 9, and the destruction of the lawless one's followers, verses 10 through 12. What we are focused on here is the first item that Paul mentions as to why his audience was not yet in the day of the Lord, or the tribulation period. Paul is clear that first must come the apostasy, or the falling away, verse 3. Now, the English expression apostasy or falling away comes from the Greek noun apostasia. There are two major views on what is meant through the noun apostasia. The majority view is that it is speaking of a spiritual departure, such as the unbelieving world embracing the Antichrist. Most Christians today believe this is what is meant, and that is the sign that Paul gives here. However, there is an entirely different view on this topic. According to the second view, the apostasia is not a spiritual departure, but rather represents a physical or spatial departure. If this latter view is accurate, Paul's simple point to the Thessalonian believers is that they could not possibly be in the tribulation period because your physical departure or the pre-tribulation rapture that I've already taught you about has not transpired. Now, what difference does it really make if 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 3 is speaking of a spiritual departure or a physical departure? The reason it matters is because there has been for over at least the last century a vigorous debate among those who believe in a future tribulation period and a subsequent kingdom concerning the question when the rapture will take place relative to the coming tribulation. If verse 3 is talking about a physical departure and not a spiritual departure, then the debate concerning when the rapture will transpire is all but over. Paul says, "That day will not come unless the falling away comes first." The word translated first is the Greek adjective proton, which means first of all. If a physical departure must transpire before the day of the Lord can even begin, then it becomes a decisive victory for pre-tribulationalism. Thus, how one interprets 2 Thessalonians 2:3 is of grave consequence to the long-standing debate concerning the timing of the rapture. I believe that what is spoken of here is not a spiritual departure, but rather a physical departure, which would be a great source of evidence favoring the pre-tribulation view. What I would like to do is present 10 reasons why I believe that the physical or spatial understanding of apostasia in 2 Thessalonians 2:3 is the correct interpretation, and why the spiritual departure view is an inadequate interpretation. In the prior installment, we noted that since doctrinal departures would have been considered normative throughout the church age, how could that in and of itself be a definitive sign of the end? Also, the Thessalonian letters are very early letters, where Paul does not get into the subject of an end-time doctrinal or spiritual departure. In this treatment, we will note 2 additional reasons why apostasia in 2 Thessalonians 2:3 should be understood as a physical departure rather than a spiritual departure. The definite article before the noun apostasia. There is a definite article in front of the noun apostasy. 2 Thessalonians 2:3 says, "Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition." Notice the definite article translated "the" in front of both falling away and man of sin. By providing these 2 definite articles, essentially, Paul is indicating that the apostasy will be something that has specific, time-bound qualities, just like the man of sin's coming has such qualities. In other words, just like the advent of the man of sin will be specific, an instantaneous event in future history, the coming apostasia, or departure, will be specific and time-bound. The advent of the coming lawless one, or Antichrist, will take place at a specified point in time and instantaneously and concurrently with the opening of the first seal judgment, Revelation 6, 1-2. The definite article also before the apostasia indicates that in the same way the apostasia will also take place instantaneously. Such an instantaneous manifestation does not fit well with the notion of a spiritual departure, which typically transpires gradually over an elongated process. Spiritual departures are not instantaneous events. After all, it took the church at Ephesus 3 decades to spiritually depart from Christ by leaving its first love. However, unlike gradual spiritual departures, the rapture of the church will be an instantaneous event that will take place in a moment in the twinkling of an eye, 1 Corinthians 15:51. Thus, the use of the 2 definite articles indicates that the apostasia will take place just as instantly as the coming forth of the lawless one. This understanding better harmonizes with interpreting the apostasia as the instantaneous removal of the church through the rapture rather than a gradual doctrinal erosion. The noun apostasia can refer to a physical departure. Those arguing for a doctrinal departure interpretation of 2 Thessalonians 2:3 typically contend that the only other time the noun apostasia is used in the Greek New Testament is in Acts 21:21. This verse says, "And they have been told about you that you are teaching all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake the law of Moses." The noun translated "forsake" here is also the Greek noun apostasia. In other words, Paul was accused in Acts 21:21 in a totally different context of leading a spiritual apostasy or departure away from the law of Moses. Spiritual departure advocates of 2 Thessalonians 2:3 contend that since the noun apostasia clearly means a spiritual departure in Acts, which is the only other time the noun is ever used in the Greek New Testament, then that is what the noun also must mean in 2 Thessalonians 2:3. However, such methodology represents a shallow way of determining a word's meaning. Words mean things based upon their unique context. When you travel to a removed, remote context in an entirely different book of the Bible that is the product of an entirely different human author to establish the meaning of a word, you are employing an inadequate method of interpretation, since the remote context of Acts 21:21 most likely gives the same word, apostasia, an entirely different meaning than the one found in 2 Thessalonians 2:3. Although the Greek noun apostasia can refer to a doctrinal departure in Acts, this noun is not a technical word, meaning a word that always means the same thing everywhere it is used. The Greek noun apostasia is a compound word, which means that it is a word that is created by combining two previously existing words. The first word is the Greek preposition apo, which means away from. The second is the Greek verb histmia, which means to stand. Thus, apostasia simply means to stand away from or to depart. The question then becomes, depart from what? Only by examining how this word is used in its immediate context will determine what the departure is, whether it be a spiritual or physical departure. Thus, apostasia does not inherently mean doctrinal departure, although it can mean that if the context calls for it. Furthermore, apostasia does not inherently mean physical departure, although, as I argue later, it can also mean that if the context demands it. Context then becomes the critical factor in determining what the apostasia or departure is from. The Greek noun apostasia can in some contexts refer to a physical departure. We know this to be the case since Lydell and Scott, a well-known Greek lexicon, uses the following terms to define apostasy. Quote, rebellion against God, apostasy, departure, disappearance, distance. While the first two definitions favor a spiritual departure understanding, the latter three entries favor a physical or spatial departure view. In Lampe's A Patristic Greek Lexicon, defines apostasia as revolt, defection, apostasy from paganism, Judaism, Christianity, orthodoxy, divorce, departure, standing aloof. While the first three definitions favor a spiritual departure understanding, the latter three entries favor a physical or spiritual departure view. H. Wainhouse notes the chronological significance of these two lexical sources and why they have a bearing on the meaning of the word apostasia during the New Testament period. Quote, the noun form allows for apostasia as a simple departure in the classical period, proved by examples from Lydell and Scott. If one says that this is not important because the meaning is only classical or ancient and thus lost its meaning by the time of the New Testament, then I may turn to the same root meaning of apostasia in the patristic era immediately following the New Testament period as indicated in the definitions for the noun form. Although the noun is used in the sense of spatial departure is not the normal meaning, during New Testament times, the word is found with this meaning in time periods before and after the New Testament era, and is likely to have been understood this way at least sometimes. Therefore, quite clearly, the noun apostasia can in some contexts refer to a physical or spatial removal, and therefore, as previously noted, cannot be a technical word. And in this and prior installments, we have noted that the first four of 10 reasons why apostasia of 2 Thessalonians 2:3 should be understood as a physical departure rather than a spiritual departure. Since doctrinal departures would have been considered normative through church age, how could that in and of itself be a definitive sign of the end? Also, the Thessalonian letters are very early letters, where Paul does not get into the subject of an end-time doctrinal or spiritual departure. Moreover, the definite article in front of the noun apostasia lends support to the physical departure view by conveying its instantaneous rather than gradual nature. In addition, the noun apostasia can very clearly refer to a physical departure. All right, so that was probably a lot, brothers and sisters, but that's just a little sampling of the articles that Andy Woods has on pre-trib.org. I just suggest that you continue to read these articles and do your own diligence. Look at both sides of the debate. Look at Lee, what he's saying, and then look at Andy. And then what I would do is just a simple guy. I consider myself a simple guy. Is go to the verses yourself and just swap out physical departure or spiritual departure within the context of those verses and see what best makes sense in the context. What was Paul originally trying to say? What was he trying to convey to the Thessalonians? What was the topic at hand in verse 1? And what did he already discuss in 1 Thessalonians 4? God bless.